just better for my back to say that.
Well, I think,
I come at this one again, the second.
This one?
No, the third. This is the third one here. I think I've covered this one. You know, I was talking about how the reds start coming in. Bill began to put that in place, because I did that panel at home, and then I brought that in. But we were trying to deal with the police brutality and basically the inhumanity that blacks were going through. And then the police, literally, that's out of a scene where they're arresting a lady all the way down to the ground for whatever reason, and then carrying her off with the dress handling up, and then over to the side, incarceration. So that was that scene. Now, let's go to the next one. It's only a couple more. Now, this is the fourth phase of the Walrus Bed. Of a lady named Rosa Moore, who was over at Malcolm X at the time, came by and saw the fact that the wall had been, some suspicious spy had gutted the wall, and some of the panels had already been taken down. So she has Bill permission to take some of those, along with what was on the other side that we had painted on, and erect them on the campus of Malcolm X. So I look at this as being the fourth phase of it. We have some of the same panels that was on the original wall, there's work, and the ones that were across from them. Okay? Let's see the next one, the fifth. Okay, the fifth phase, this is the original location of the Walrus Bed. The city constructed something like a four-pointed star with rounded edges. And they were having artists to come in and make a bid on the design and et cetera, et cetera. Now, the first time Bill and I went in to the center and submitted our proposal, we got no response whatsoever. But when I got involved with the Artists in Residence program, I was asked would I be willing to paint on the same location of the original Walrus Bed. And quite naturally, you know, I jumped at that opportunity. Now, the original thing was all concrete construct. The city wanted somebody to paint directly on the wall itself. And so I saw them with the idea that if I do it in Portsmouth now, then it will be free, it will be free maintenance, and it wouldn't need any upkeep in at that time. And so the city went with that idea. I got about $30,000 in the course of now and the rest of the material that they had to pay for the installation. I know that cost probably about the same amount, if not more. So the city invested in that in terms of the original site. Now, it's made out of porcelain enamel. How did I get involved in porcelain enamel? Well, two professors that were teaching at the Art Institute at the time, George Stahl and Harold Hayden, they were the ones that were teaching porcelain enamel. Bill was already in the Institute studying that technique. He asked me would I be interested in coming in. So I came in, and that's how I learned how to do porcelain enamel under George Stahl and Professor Harold Hayden. And then that's why I was able to sell the city on that idea where it would be maintenance free. If we look at the other slide, which is a close-up, as you may or may not know, Dr. Kane was never on the original wall. And that's because of I think the militant down at that time, they refused to have him put on there because they had him classified as not so militant. And they were not interested in that. They were more interested in the Malcolm and the Stokely Carmichael and the Rap Brown and that kind of thing. Now, this is called King Memorial Murals, a portion poison apple. Anybody knows about poison apple? It's very durable. You can cook on it, you can bake on it, whatever it is, like you use in the stove, whatever. Now, I have Kenny here, and this is a memorial to him. Now, what is Kenny doing? Well, the whole idea is to break the chains of what we were dealing with, and those chains were dealing with the oligarchy, what Franklin Delano Roosevelt called the raw, economic rawness. These are the people that control the wealth and the richness of a country and society. So that's what that was in terms of opening up for all kinds of people. So you got the guy underneath the eagle representing the oligarchy, or we can say the economic rawness. And over to the left, I put Carl Robeson, Marcus Garvey, and Malcolm X. And to the left and the right of Dr. King, I got a piece, a doll, and then the other is the panther. So it was a decision, which way are you going to have to go to acquire what you're after? Dr. King is nonviolent, peaceful. The other force is the force that says we're going to acquire anything if necessary. So it was a there's always a choice. So I put the oil, I put the gold, you know, the economy, the richness. These were the things that black people needed to share here, not just a few people. So this is the last stage of the poison now. The rest of it that you can see, I dealt with not only all the figures that were on the original wall, but I included educational ones, inventors, and sports, okay? Now, if we look at the last thing, and then I'm gonna close up, let's look at that. The last slide is where you see Bill and I, when we were not so mature with gray hair at the time. And there's Bill in the center. Bill and I took the whole movement of the original wall and we began to move to Detroit. We did about three or four little pennies in Detroit. Bill and I worked together and worked as a team. Now, we talked about the legacy of the wall. Bill's greatest ambition was to somehow raise funds to get an international wall where you had all, people from all over, regardless of sex, gender, religion, or whatever, to be able to come and have a section and pay. That was his last kind of request. He didn't have the funds to do it. He was not able to raise it at that particular time. He ends up passing on. So I think if we really want to share the legacy of Bill Walker, we could kind of think about his dream.